chosen few.
No, I'm sure you know, a couple of students said that today they won't be here, so there's still hope. But we are in a very volatile situation. Take a few sips of coffee. Yeah, no cow. Yeah, no, it's, everything's cool, I'm just kidding, but you see the fluctuations, you feel them. But a couple of guys said that won't be able to make it today. The integral of the coffee effect. Right. It's good to wait a couple of seconds to drink coffee and then you're on a better page. Alright. So, for your chosen few, let me recap on what we did up until now. I hope you had a nice time off. If you did some exams and good luck with that. We're gonna talk a little bit more about what we measure, okay, about the Bode signal and some features of the Bode signal which we need to discuss and go over before we start getting into the more advanced designs. And hopefully today start talk about the visual system and the visual cortex. Its organization and start talking about retinotopy and hopefully next week we'll finish retinotopy and start talking about the receptive fields and population receptive fields and get to the more interesting stuff this month. Okay, so before we discuss design type, let me summarize in two sentences what we already know about the Bode signal, right? So the level of oxygenization in the blood affects the magnetic field. So we got a metabolic measurement. This is what we measure, right? We study the dynamics of that Bode signal, right? The hemodynamic response function, which we'll talk about more today. We know more or less, at least we can explain some of the shape of the dynamics of the Bode signal. We know about the vascular system. And today we'll talk about how you can, what you can do basically with this response function, how you can combine them, let's say, and use them to create various efficient designs. Okay, so broadly speaking, and we'll come back to that several times along the course, when we're talking about conducting an fMRI experiment, we have several designs that we can use. One is called block design, it's the most simple design, in which you you have some paradigm, you present some stimuli, and you present them in a chain of stimuli, one block, then you let the system cool down, the system might be in the brain, and then you present another, let's say, condition in which you present a different stimuli, and so on and so forth. You have event-related design. These can be fast or slow. The slow is very simple, as you can see. You, again, between each event, you let the system relax. The rapid or fast event-related design is a bit more complex. We'll talk about it later today. And finally, you can create something that is a kind of a mixed bag. Okay, you have some kind of blocks, but within the blocks you have alternating event types. I won't talk about this too much because it's not very common. Okay, so the ball time course. Again, this is just repeating what we already know. We have this initial dip here at the beginning, which we said is more translates better maybe the location of the actual activity that goes on, right? So the spatial resolution is better here, but the signal strength is very slow. We usually cannot work with it. Then we have the rise, okay, and this is, remember what drives this rise? Is it more oxygen or less oxygen?
At the beginning, it's less oxygen, and then it's more.
The beginning, again?
In the initial dip.
Yeah. Oh, in the initial dip. Okay. Yeah. All right. Correct. And then, and we'll talk about how this shape changes or what it tells us relative to the stimuli we present and relative to the design we apply. And we'll do that today, and then, like you said correctly, and then you have the undershoot, which is explained less well, I would say. It's very variable, but again, it has something to do with the ratio between the outflow of the blood from the area and the inflow of the blood. Okay, you have some temporary changes in the ratio between oxy and deoxyblood. Now, if we create a short, present a short stimulus, we usually don't get this kind of shape, okay? What you get is something closer to the impulse function, okay? So if you have, let's say this is the neuronal activity, it's very sharp, okay? You get some kind of metabolic signature, let's say, okay, this HRF. As you see now, it's much shorter, all right? It's just the result of this neuronal activity in a very short time without this prolonged plateau there, okay? And we'll see that the length of the plateau and also the height of the size, to some extent, is dependent on the stimulus, on the stimulus length and the amount of stimuli we present. So we'll talk about, so this is the basic shape, okay? And we'll see how it, how we can combo several of these shapes, depends on the stimuli, and how we get from this simple shape into more complex shape.
Now, so the right side is just the hemodynamic response function, okay? That's the kernel mm-hmm. that you convolve the neuronal response to get what mm-hmm. you expect in terms of the goal signal, right? So neuron, yeah. Actually the axis on the left for the neural response, usually if you present the stimulus, let's say for for 100 milliseconds, that's what you would get on the right, okay? And so the time axis on the left should be at the order of milliseconds. And it's really an impulse, mm-hmm. so therefore it's really an impulse.
Did you say that here we're talking about seconds, and you see that already with a very short stimulus, right?
Yeah.
You don't get that prolonged plateau, but you do get several seconds of an effect. And that's because we're talking about a metabolic process here, okay? Now, that being said, real data, it doesn't look like that, of course, and there is quite large variability in all the components we talked about, the initial dip and the rise, and especially the undershoot. And this variability is, you can see it in several cases, okay? So, in a paper that I didn't give you that
right.
paper.
You want to show again the figure before? Just to make sure that we have. So, this is individual trials here we're seeing, just to make sure that.
This is individual, I think, I don't remember if it's trial or subject, but we'll see that in a moment.
It's more, probably like an individual trial.
Let's say it's individual trials.
And the blue one is maybe the average, right? I'm just sort of trying to understand what we see.
Yeah, I actually don't remember.
The average.
I don't remember. I don't remember here. But we'll see it in a specific, we'll see specific example. So what you have here, for example, is average. This is average trials, okay? So you have some kind of experiment. I actually don't remember what the experiment was, but it was something very simple, showing a simple visual stimuli. And what you can see, the different colors are the different subjects, okay? And each curve is an average or smooth response for a set of stimuli, set of repetitions, okay? So of course it's smooth, but you can already see some things, okay? So what you see here in the left are the different subjects. If you take all the data of the different subjects and basically show the HRF of that specific subject or their response of that specific subject. Again, this is time, okay? And obviously you can see several things. You can see a difference in the rise, okay, in the rate, I would say, of the how the response rises. And you can see, you don't see a lot of difference in the peak amplitude, but you do see a major difference or major variation in the fall of the curve and the undershoot. And this, somebody has an idea. There's no complete answer for that, but somebody has an idea why. First of all, what do you see here? You see here the biggest variation is in the last phase. Okay? Now we talked about.
Also the dynamics, just as much in the dynamics, right?
And also the dynamics.
How fast you get to the peak, that's also changing quite.
Yeah, but I would say that that even at least like three of them are basically on the same. Yeah, there's also variation in that. You're right. But this is interesting because this is probably because the undershoot or the outflow of the drainage of this blood from the area is a much more complex phenomenon. Okay, and we talked about it when we talked about the vascular system. Okay, and how the signal from this part of the activity, let's say, okay, from the last part. Is affected. Everything is affected from the vascular, from the structure of the vascular system. Okay, which is different between the individual subjects. But the last part, the part in which the blood goes back into the veins, is the part of the signal that is most affected by it. Okay, because that it's a much more gradual part. Okay, basically, correct me if I'm wrong, but this is what I know of. Right? Do you have something to add here? Because I think the part.
Yeah, I think you're right. I think generally we tend to give more weight to the positive load rather than the negative load.
But I think we also understand the negative part less, because I think that the biological procedures process there is a much more complex one. It's much more dependent about the structure of the veins.
And you can see it also with individual in the same session that
so this is the
variation
part. Yeah,
here
yeah.
than here, right? I mean,
right.
It's clearly something that.
Yeah.
But can we say from the left graph that if it goes faster at the beginning, then the undershoot is larger at the end?
I don't think so.
It's just one.
It's not connected
to
parts, they don't affect.
I don't know if somebody. Tested it systematically, but I don't see any reason that this will.
But generally,
this would be.
I mean, here what you see is there may be individual differences between mm-hmm. subjects. We don't usually, in our analysis, so
go into that.
The
yeah.
canonical HRF that we apply to all areas,
okay.
to all subjects, the same hemodynamics.
So here, would he brought me to this slide? No, exactly. But so what I want to show you here is. Is this thing that you should remember somewhere in the back of your brain, although we don't use these practices usually.
It may actually be a bit of weak.
Yeah, no. I mean, what we usually think of this HRF, this 2 gamma function, we use that and we'll get in 2 weeks or so to the GLM, where we assign predictors and we convolve the predictors we assign for the task with this canonical HRF. This is how we try to predict the variability in the signal, basically model our signal. But it's important to remind ourselves that this change, again, this canonical change is just an estimation, okay? And what you see here is a different paper from Buckner. You read a different paper of Buckner from 97. We'll get to that in a second. But what you can see here, you can see several things, but what I want to focus on is the difference between regions in the brain. So what you have here is a certain subject and a different subject. What you see here is a bit kind of a different scale, but it's the percent signal change, so how much the signal sense is changed. And you can see these are averaged curves from repetition of a certain task. And what they did here is they took one slice of the brain, okay? It's all one slice here. I mean, this is one slice, and this is one slice of a different subject, but the same brain region. And they, for the same condition, the same trial, the same time points, they calculated the response function from, in this case, the left prefrontal cortex and the visual cortex, okay? Some part of the visual cortex.
And you said it's one slice?
It's one slice that covers both. That's important because you know that it's exactly the same signal, the same it was taken in one shot of the scanner. Okay? So everything physical, we talked previously about some physical heat noise, all this kind of environmental noise that are different sometimes from time point to time point or from session to session, are supposed to be the same here. It's the same reading. And you can see clearly two things. Well, the most obvious one, I think, here is the size or the amplitude of the response. But you can see another interesting thing, and it actually makes sense. You can see this difference in the dynamics, right? So the prefrontal part seems to rise later, and does that make sense in some way? I didn't tell you what the stimulus is, actually, but let's assume it's a visual stimulus.
No, it doesn't make sense. I know you would say that, okay.
I'm asking you. I don't have a complete answer.
It does make sense because of the hierarchy, right?
Right.
Some of you have taken my course in the morning, so in terms of the hierarchy, you could say, okay, first the signal starts from the retina, it gets to B1, then to B2,
mm-hmm.
and then gets to prefrontal cortex much, like a few more synapses to get to prefrontal. However, if you look at the time difference between them, it's 1 second, okay?
Mm-hmm.
If you were to look at neuronal activity, the difference would be 10 milliseconds or 20 milliseconds, okay? So it doesn't make sense in that respect, but you should expect the prefrontal to be somewhat later. But this is much more.
You would expect it in a different, very, very different scale, final resolution of
exactly.
Program, okay? You would expect like a 100 millisecond, maybe, I don't know, difference. Okay, or several cents per
millisecond.
No, you cannot see it in the
MRI. Yeah, but look also at subject 6.
No.
There's no difference.
There's no.
Right? I mean, the prefrontal
mm-hmm.
is weaker, but the time to peak is the same.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so, and again, there's the issue of, okay, why do we use the canonical HRF?
So just to make it certain.
Yeah.
All right, so the canonical, I'm not going to paint on that, but the canonical will be something here that doesn't fit perfectly to this one or this one, right?
Yeah.
So that's what you use, yeah.
And especially it wouldn't fit the difference here because there's a difference.
Of course.
So you use one canonical function
yep.
which rises and then goes down. And the answer is in part because I think to get this on an individual subject, you might didn't say this, but I mentioned before that the way you have to do this is to have an event-related
yeah,
design.
We'll talk about it in a second.
In
yes.
which you present each image, you present one image, then you,
and wait, you
wait
for
12 seconds or so, or 15 seconds for the signal to die, and then you give another one. So it's very, very time-consuming, very difficult to and you know, this was done in 1996. I don't think people are
doing
this on a regular basis because it's so difficult to get it. So,
it's just to keep in mind.
Yeah,
you have to keep in mind that you use some canonical
How do you get this canonical interval?
How do you get?
Grand average. The grand basically.
How they came up with that? I don't know. Do you know the guys that?
Across subjects, you do the grand mean across subjects, and that is your canonical.
No, but the HR, the two gamma thing, what you can move.
So you're looking for a model which would best fit your data, okay? And of course, with variation across subjects and variation across areas is just the Yuval show, but you do the grand average and you get.
So it's something that I calculate.
When I mean you, I don't mean you in person.
Yeah.
They did it once.
Yeah.
So, and
since then, you
okay,
assume
so your
to
question,
be the hemodynamic response function.
So for your question, all the analysis software you're going to use, they have this kernel presented to you. You can apply it. Sometimes you can choose not to use that canonical one. And you can choose a different variation of that or tweak it a bit if you have reason to believe that your signal should be modeled differently. But again, like Uli says, 99% of the people don't bother
on an individual basis. So it's just
time consuming. And usually it works. I mean, it's a good enough estimation to allow you. And we'll talk about in a second estimation versus detection. So usually you want to detect some changes and not estimate exactly the shape of the HRS. Okay, if you want to estimate exactly, then you have to think this through. We'll get to that in a second. So this is just a couple of minutes. It took me more than a couple of minutes, but I wanted to remind you that we're working with the noisy data, noisy signal, in essence. Okay, we try to estimate it the best we can. And now we get to what I asked you to read, and that is a paper, we'll get to that in a second, that talks about the linearity of the bold response. And let me first say what I mean by that, and then why it's important. So this diagram shows some kind of a scheme about the signal coming from the stimulus, being processed by the neurons, creates some neuronal response. There's the hemodynamics that surrounds the neuron, and then we get some signal, and of course there is noise in the middle, and this noise here is the noise that we talked about before, the noise in the scanner. There's other kinds of noise around this process, but the noise in this stage is the noise not only from the scanner, also the biological noise, but that goes into our estimation of the fMRI signal.
Biological
noise,
you mean the neuronal response as well.
Neuronal response.
If you have the same stimulus, and you would not get exactly the same.
But also a hemodynamic. Everything that's biological and changes from time to time. And also, of course, system noise and environmental noise. This is a scheme, I think, from Polgrak. Yeah, from the textbook that shows. We'll see it through in a couple of seconds, but shows some kind of expected bold activation or HRF response. It's not exactly HRF. And next to it, the source of the neuronal response. Okay, and what you can see here, and for this slide you have to believe me, but we'll talk about it, is that if you get some kind of signal, you expect some kind of bold activation. If you have a higher amplitude or higher strength of neuronal response, you expect some kind of correlating response. And it's not just any kind, right? It should, we'll talk about it, but it's suggested that we have some kind of mapping between the two, okay? So if you have twice the strength of the neuronal response, then you have twice the strength of the bold activation. And as a consequence of that, or as a if this ratio, this linear transition holds, then that means also that if you have a couple of let's say stimuli and then a couple of responses from the neurons, you can combine this in a linear way to create the overall signal that you get. Okay, so for example, in these two consecutive activities, neuron activities, you have these two equally, more or less, okay, disregarding noise, equally created both responses, and since the dynamics are pretty much, they're not impulse response, as we just saw, they take in the minimum couple several seconds to rise and fall, then you have some kind of, this time, let's say that you have both of these activations are ongoing, and you have some kind of summation. Okay, so this is the assumption. It's very important, and we'll now go over
the summation is linear summation.
It's linear summation.
Okay, that's important.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
You can,
yeah.
You can.
You can deduce this by adding these two.
Yeah, just
at a very add every. Let me. Yeah. Thank you.
Yeah.
Every single time point, you can add these two and get the blue one. Okay, this is the assumption.
And the first assumption is not a trivial one. Think about it, okay?
Okay, yeah.
Because if you, let's say, in terms of the neurons, okay, you increase the contrast of the stimulus. Well, typically, as maybe you will show in a minute,
mm-hmm.
the response of the neurons increases, okay? In a sort of a.
But it's not linear.
Okay, so it increases, but at some point it saturates, okay?
Mm-hmm.
It doesn't really matter if the contrast is 100% or 50%, it reaches the saturation. But also, with the bold response, you can think, okay, the bold response is due to the increased oxygenated blood flowing into this region. Well, this is the mask, you know, just think about this as a sort of a tube in which you pass blood through, oxygenated blood. There's a limit to how much you can go, okay?
Mm-hmm.
So both have a saturation point at some point. And the point here is
mm-hmm.
that you want, you want to make sure that the two are correlated, so
mm-hmm.
that, okay, if the neural response is double the response, also the bold response will be double. It's not assured, it's not trivial that would be assured, and certainly it's not the case in some regimes, okay? So,
mm-hmm.
but in general, that's the first assumption. The second one is the assumption of linearity in time. It's also not a trivial one, but that was proven experimentally, as I think you might have shown.
Yeah, this is what we'll go over now.
So without it, we would be, there's no sense in working with the functional imaging if you don't have the linearity, because then you cannot,
especially if you're doing
you cannot resolve the individual.
Well, you can do it if you in a very, very, very limited way. If you do a slow event related with one stimulus, it can work. We'll get to that. We'll get to that in a few minutes.
Yeah.
But it's important what we said, and you have to remember then that because, like I said, the response of the neurons to the stimuli is not usually, it's not always linear. Okay, so it's not that you increase the contrast and it rises in a linear way. So it also means that if I have something that is not rising linearly, let's say the neural response doesn't rise linearly, and we want to correlate, well, it means that if the bold rises, it will also rise non-linearly in this case. Well,
it
depends on your resolution, basically, but this is the case. So the bold needs to be correlated, basically, to the neuronal response, but since the amount of firing by the neuron is not linearly correlated to the let's say intensity of the stimulus, that means that also the bold doesn't have to be linearly correlated to the intensity of the
it should reflect
the neurons, exactly, not the stimulus, not the stimulus, because again, if the stimulus mapping, if the neuron mapped one to one the intensity of the stimulus, then the bold would do that as well. But if the neurons are not mapping one to one, or maybe in some nonlinear or some more complex way, the intensity or the complexity of the stimuli, so should the bold. Okay,
how
does it
look like when the in the neuronal level, like the firing level is linear, and the neuronal level, the firing rate?
I'm talking about firing rate.
But
firing rate is usually not linear. It's not linear. It's some kind of, there is, first of all,
she was trying to look up.
Yeah, I think so.
Yes, sir. These neurons is what
I was doing in the past.
Yeah.
You far less. I've been giving you the lecture on the neutron firing, but just to make the point. So this would be a contrast here.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, from 0 to 100%. Okay, and this would be the sorry. This would be firing rate, and this would be contrast.
Sorry.
Yeah. Oh, yes.
Yeah, we can't see it very well.
Okay, so the delta. Still can't see, we'll turn on the light. Graph, the graph would be something like that. Okay? So there's some threshold contrast that you need for the neuron to fire above its, I don't know, spontaneous rate of 2-3 spikes per second. And then at some point it saturates. Okay? So there's 100% contrast and, I don't know, 50% contrast, you get pretty much the same response. Okay? And that's nonlinear. Okay? But there is a region where it's practically linear. Okay? But of course it's nonlinear. Now, what Yuval was saying is that if you were looking at the bulb response, the bulb response should be something like that, okay? To be correlated with a neuronal response. Now, the axis here is going to be different. That would be percent signal change. But in order for the bulb response to reflect the neurons, you want this to be correlated. That's the point, that it should have the same.
It's not the same time frame, but it's.
Yeah. You're looking, in terms of time, it's delayed and it's longer, but if you look at the bulb response, the amplitude here, you're using low contrast, here you're using higher contrast. Yeah, okay.
We don't see it exactly here, but you have some kind of. Right? It's not completely linear, you have saturation. And
here you were talking about in time.
In time, yes.
I was talking here about the function of contrast. Okay? So
yes,
if
true.
Okay, it's not the same thing that we're talking about.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, so to prove that, they did a kind of simple experiment back in the 90s, but a very important one. The stimulus was very, very simple. Flickering checkerboard, I think it was 8 hertz or something like that. Yeah, it's written here, 8 hertz. Activates the visual cortex very well. Okay, and they have several, this is Buckner and colleagues. So the stimulus is very simple, and it's presented, there were several versions of the experiment, but one version that we're going to talk about, signal was presented for 2 seconds, okay? So we have this flickering image for 2 seconds, and then we have some blank period, okay? So it's very simple. And remember what we said a couple of minutes ago? When you have, when I said also that you want to estimate the shape of the HRF, you want to use this kind of event-related with a long blank interval to let the system relax and see the full development, dynamic development of the HRF. And this is what they did. But what they did also is varied between the different length of the stimulus. So the basic stimulus, I said, was 2 seconds, but they used concatenated different trials, okay, together to create longer stimuli. So, for example, a one trial would be 2 seconds, or 1 second, I don't remember, and the two trial one would be two consecutive trials of these 2 seconds. So, overall, 4 seconds stimuli, okay? And now they had a full development of the curve for the one trial. This is average of over repetitions. So basically, this is showing 2 seconds of flickering checkerboard, and this is 4 seconds, and later they have also three trials, okay, which was 6 seconds. And what they showed, they did something, I hope you read it, but they did something intuitively simple. One time they took this shape. The second time they took the two trial shape and subtracted this one from it, okay? and they got this second curve, this estimated second curve, okay? So what you have here, this is again the time and percent signal change, we should be used to that by now. What you have here is the first trial, what was estimated directly from the experiment, and then what was estimated from subtracting the first the single trial from the second, from two consecutive trials. And you can see that they are basically the same. Well, not exactly, but we talked about that there is variation. Even if you measure both of them, there would be variation. But it's very, very, very similar. Okay? So that was a nice proof of concept that you can estimate estimate the shape of a single trial by, again, linearly subtracting one trial from another. From the shorter trial, you subtract it from the longer trial. And what you see here is the activation level. I don't want to go into the details here because they don't matter, but they did, they used this, we'll talk about GLM later, but they used this estimated activation, estimated HRF from the subtraction. They used them to create this map. So what you see here are basically p-values, so you try to see statistically which voxel in the brain is active, more active in the trials here. The trials, again, was the checker, the flickering checkerboard, so these regions were more active when the checkerboard was flashed than when it was not flashed. So what you see here are the actual one trial activation from seeing 2 seconds of checkerboard, and this is seeing 4 seconds of checkerboard minus seeing 2 seconds of checkerboard. Okay? It's the same as what we saw before, but here in doing the statistics and showing the significant voxels. And again, without going into details, it's very, very similar. Okay? This is a nice, I think it was, well, I was too young, but I think it was very nice result at the time. And they continue to do it even with 3 trials. So again, if you take the 3, the response to the 6 seconds of flickering checkboard, and subtract the response you get for the 2 trials, you should get the 1 trial. So again, 6 seconds minus 4 seconds give you 2 seconds, and so on. And again, this is what they found. So you have the real first trial, the estimated second trial, and the estimated, but they did all this different, right? Removing the second, removing the first, and so on. And basically, they got 3 very similar estimation of a single trial, 2 seconds of a checker board. Okay? So this is the first thing. So this is very nice. So this, and we'll talk about the rapid eventuality towards the end of this lecture. And this is very important, especially when we, as Udi said, when we have some kind of response that in some part of it overlap a different response, and you want to see what is what. Okay, if I show one stimulus and for, let's say, for a second, and then and I don't show anything for 20 seconds, then I'm good. I know exactly what is related to this stimulus. Okay, if I want to show some things more rapidly, I should be able to. I should know that the total amount of signal that I see is somehow a linear combination of the different products that I put in my design. We'll see that in a minute. Then there was another experiment by Boynton that demonstrated something very related, but a bit different. So here we're talking about the contrast sensitivity function. Well, no, it's not contrast sensitivity, sorry. It's a percent signal. I don't know if it's percent signal.
You can see the contrast level.
Yeah. No. But the scale here is not contrast. The scale is just activation. But the three graphs in each one of them is different contrast level. Okay. And what you see here is first and foremost the dynamics of the HRF in relation to the stimulus length and the contrast. Okay. So basically, let's take, let's first explain one graph here. It's easier to see, and then we talk about the whole. So what you see here is
three conscious level, the three HRF, which resulted, and here you see the stimulus, okay, the length, this is the time the stimulus was on, and the most apparent thing is that the ball changes, the length of the ball response changing with the length of the stimulus. Okay, that's the most the first thing you should know, and it's not only changing. Okay, I'll show it in a minute. It changes in a very certain way. Next, you can see that there is a difference in the amplitude of the response according to the contrast. Okay, how is it linear? Do you think it's linear?
Yes.
How is it linear? It's not so hard, it's not so easy to see here, but it's not exactly linear. What do you think it's linear?
Because the difference is
measured
fresh.
Yeah, but it's a bit tricky because the difference here.
Yeah, it's tricky.
It's tricky. This is 0.25 and this is 0.5, so it's actually not very linear. But I agree that maybe it was a trick question on my behalf because it's confusing this. This, the way it's presented.
Linear with law of contrast.
What?
Linear with law of contrast.
Exactly. So exactly, it's linear with what we said before. It goes well with this. Well, we don't see it directly, but you can trust me on that. Or we trust Woody. It goes well with the contrast sensitivity function, not with the absolute. And it's not linear. Linear it goes with the absolute contrast level. Okay. And. Yes, of course.
What they're showing here is a linear relationship between stimulus and ball.
Well, the length of the ball. Yeah. No, okay. So that's what we said now. So the.
Oh,
sorry. So yeah. So I probably didn't explain it that well, but the actual rise or the difference in the level of activation. Is in corresponding to the level of intensity of the contrast, but it's not a linear relationship. Again, why? It's like I said, it's a bit tricky. You can see that this is just intuitively, all right? But intuitively, if you look at this, you can see that it rises in a very steady way. But the actual difference between the first two contrasts is half of the difference between the two contrasts. So actually, if it was linear, this should be around here, okay? Now that's not actually the most important thing. What you can show here is that it follows again this rule. But again, it's a bit tricky. But it follows this function. Okay. Now of course it can be somewhere in the linear also part. And
I talk about this.
I think let's stick with maybe with that.
No.
In two weeks, there's all the relationship between the. Yeah. And Udi does it much better than me. That's his specialty. But in short, it's not exactly linear. It goes with the contrast sensitivity function. Do you do that in the? In the physiology?
No.
Okay, so let's finish this this experiment, and then we go after the break to the design. Okay.
Wait, I missed what you explained there on the board with the linearity.
Yeah, I think Odie's right. He'll explain much better than me in a couple of weeks. But no, I'm just saying. Let's just wrap it up and then never come back to that. At least today. The amplitude of the ball corresponds with this function, not to the actual. It's not linearly correlated to the intensity level, the contrast level of the stimulus. Okay, but it correlates with the neuronal activity. That being said, there is a linear part of this contrast sensitivity function, so it can be that you. Measure a part of the contrast change that is that translates linearly to the neurons, and
then you have a linear transformation from the stimulus to the neuron, and then you have also, since you have a linear transformation from the neuron to the ball, you have overall linear transformation. But this is just subparts of this whole function, okay? So in all, it doesn't have to follow a linear connection to the contrast sensitivity, contrast, to the contrast, yeah, exactly. Okay. So again, they did some similar trick here, like we talked about the previous article, when you had this kind of graph, and then you have a two trial, and then you can subtract one from the other. They checked here. They checked the varied only the length, again, the length of the stimuli, and they did some calculation which you could predict, again, from one set of let's say set of stimuli. We had the one condition which you presented stimuli for 6 seconds, 12 seconds, or 24 seconds, and you can calculate each one of these nodes from the other. Okay, so if you have two 12 seconds, you can create a 24 second response. If you have a 6 second response, you have to create a 24 second and 12 and so on. So it's kind of elaborating what we just saw. Okay, the take home message basically from this thing, we'll leave this for this. The take home message for this part is, first, the ball is very variable, okay, and we use some canonical HRF to estimate it more or less, okay. In most, I think what Udi said is very true, in most experiments that you will or other use today, you want to detect the change of the signal and less estimate the exact curve of the HRF, okay. So you use a canonical HRF. The second is the linearity of the ball, okay? So we have a dependence, some dependence on the stimulus contrast or strength, but the linearity is that you can, first, you can correlate, there's correlation between the ball and the neural activity, okay? And that's what's important. We see those two go together, okay? That's a very good, very good sign that you're looking at something real that has to do with neural processing. And then you can linearly summate or subtract the different, let's say, impulse function, different response, HRF responses. And in 10 minutes, after we go back from the break, you'll see why that is important. We'll dive into the different designs that we can use, and we'll see why it's important, okay? So 5 minutes, 10 minutes break. Get some water. Continue. Thank you.
Hey, what's going on, huh? How's Nesta and everybody?
I didn't have to, didn't you, a long time. You finished collecting and now you're analyzing and writing and...
Yeah, well, I need to make some calls to the patients with finger and little finger and more than that.
And analyzing?
Analyzing, well...
You have some, like, are you gonna make, like, you need to do, like, several papers or something? Or just whatever comes? But not everything has to be published, right? So it works for three papers. What's your deal with data?
I think for the PhD.
Yeah.
Like, doesn't have to be published.
Publishable.
Publishable.
In the progress of submission or something. So you have already know exactly what like what APC very like said, and or you still initial. No, but not with them, I mean, for you, like, you yourself, you know.
More or less. Although the Optimerate spaces are quite hard to get, tricky to get at least.
But one paper went to compare Optimerate with healthy population, but yes, the answer is that. And for that specific one, you don't have the whole data set. Now I should know, but when I did the PhD, I didn't think about it. Why, you mean ethically?
No, more like...
Because
the comparison keeps moving up.
Oh, yeah, you mean by that. Physically, you mean. But if you do a totally different analysis...
Connectivity instead of your family.
Yeah. So it's a different measurement. You're taking a different measurement from the data set and direct to the data
set.
I think so. I mean, makes sense. It's not that you're using the same GLM to.
Well, maybe the same. I know I talk HR.
That I'm sure. Yeah.
Okay. Which is interesting stuff.
Technical stuff today, so we can start going
over. We won't be here next week. Next week we will be here, and in 2 weeks
we won't. Okay, 2 weeks I won't be here as well. So that's
Udi's
class. It's Udi's class. So that's good because you both can ask him on your free time. I got a before going to the starting with the visual system, we want to finish what I want to talk about the ball more, a bit more. So we have neuronal activity, we have some kind, it's not exactly neuronal activity, but we have some kind of, it could be activity itself or a predictor. We have some canonical response, this is the, like I said, standard 2 gamma HRF, hemodynamic response function,
You can tweak it a little bit, but this is basically what you do. And you convolve the two. If you convolve the two, you get some kind of, you get this, basically. You can recognize this shape that we talked about. Okay, so this is the basic way to estimate, at least model the what you would expect response to be. Now, talk about the convolution. Okay, so we have some vector, okay, or input vector, or a set of values, either positive or negative. And this is just an example, okay? You have some kind of response with a certain amplitude. It's positive, then a larger, not response, sorry, some kind of input stimulus or whatever input. This is purely schematic, but you have something with a low positive input, and then a high positive input, and a negative input, and a positive input. And so you can take all these inputs at the different time points, okay, and convolve or combine each of them with canonical HRF, okay? And then this is purely mathematics. You get these kinds of different convolution, different results. And if you sort them in the appropriate way on the time frame, this is the beginning of time and going right, the time advances, then you can combine this. And again, because we're talking about a linear summation, linear composition, you can just combine these and get this complex shape. Okay? And in a basically what you usually get is, well, you get some kind of predictor, you have some kind of time points, and you design your test, so you know at which time point you know what happened or what stimulus was presented. You can take this onset of the stimulus, for example, convolve it with the HRF, okay? And your data is this, basically. You want to try, you try to see how you can best describe this data with the list of time points that you have, okay? You have your time points of the task, you convolve with the HRF, and you see if you combine them linearly, and that is the GLM, the general linear model. You can combine it linearly, and see if you can get basically your data with the least amount of error. Okay, you can explain most of this complex figure. You can explain, you want to explain it as much as you can with your predictions.
Just 1 minute, but going back to this, can you go back?
Yeah.
To make the point. So you have this, right? This is what you get, your output from the MRI, right? And what you're trying to get, basically, is the these functions here. That's the contribution of individual events, right? So that would be event one, event two. Let's say this would be the event you present faces. Mm-hmm. And this you present, I don't know, scenes. And this you present something else. So there's three different events, okay, that you present these pictures. No matter we get into this, I'm just giving you a sort of forward of this. And then you get this. You know the timing of your specific events, and what you're trying to say, this is the contribution that you got for giving a face. And this is the contribution that you got when giving a scene. Okay? And so on and so forth. And this is based on the linear assumption. Mm-hmm. If the signals did not sum up linearly, you couldn't have done that. Okay? So you need the linear assumption for that.
The linear assumption and the idea that you know that this, that the canonical function basically stays the same.
Exactly.
So what changes is the relative weight and timing of this, guys. Okay, it's the weight, the sign is positive, negative, and so on, and the timing of these guys, and then you can estimate.
So we get the output and we go backwards.
More or less.
Do what's called the deconvolution.
And are we interested in the vectors or just the?
Well, the vectors here are just schematic vectors. What you usually have is, again, the time point of your different conditions. So let's say in time point A, like we say, you have faces, and so this is something you design, right? You know your design matrix, basically. What people call, what you'll see a design matrix is basically, it starts with 0 and 1 when you activated, let's say, when you show faces, all right, convolved again with this HRF. Okay, so at every given time point, you have exactly what you would expect the signal to be, mm-hmm. assuming there is no noise and no other thing. Of course, there is always noise.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
So the point.
But like what I said, this is what you get, right? This is what you work with. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And assuming you build your task in a very logical way.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So there are two things. You can see, you have, let's say, you have your own logic of showing faces versus houses, and you know the time, it's now.
Mm-hmm.
You can, so you have basically a set of vectors in this very simple vector, let me show you, it's kind of a GLM thing, but we started talking about it, so why not? Let's say we don't have different heights and stuff. What we have is, let's make it simplest, here we have nothing, but, yeah. Here we have, this is the time, here we have faces, here we have house, face, and house, okay? So let's assume it's faces and this and one voxel, faces, so this is the onset, but actual values, let's say, it's different, because if we have a voxel that, let's take one voxel that activates when there's we show a house, but deactivate, let's make it extreme, when you show a face, okay? So the activation profile will actually be like this, up, down, up, okay? So houses up, faces down. So this is the signal, okay, the stream activation. Now you convolve each of this with the HRF, okay? You multiply it by the HRF, the canonical HRF, and you get some, because there is delay and there's overlap, so you get something complex, right? There's some maybe down in the beginning, but then goes up in the summation. It's very hard to think about it. So, okay, so let's now say, so this strange thing here is what you get if this voxels, follow this behavior. Now let's, if you have a real data, okay, so you get the real data. Real data can be something like this, or it could be something totally different, okay? It could be something like this, okay? Now, it could be two things. It could be that this sample data that I showed here, I don't know if you see it, but it's just a sample data, could be explained by this behavior. It could be that it cannot be explained by this behavior, or it can explain that this data can be explained by this in a very inefficient way, okay? So it's also a result. That means basically that the voxel that we are checking now doesn't follow this pattern, okay? Because if it would follow this pattern, because we have a linear summation, we could explain this by this, okay? And then we can assume, so we test the voxel basically. We give the data, we see if we can explain the data about this, then this voxel may be, or it has to, responds in this pattern, okay? So now we can say something about the voxel that we can safely assume, or it's reasonable to say, that it differentiates between houses and faces, okay? If we cannot explain it, so the voxel does something different. It can be something that has to do with houses and faces, but in a different way.
Mm-hmm.
Or it can be a voxel that has nothing to do with houses and faces, okay? Because we couldn't explain the data by this. So this is the linear summation. This is the basis of GLM, of what you usually do, okay? It's more complicated,
mm-hmm.
but this is the gist. If you get this logic, this is it, okay? You want to and you never can explain all of this
mm-hmm.
by this, but you want to maximize you always are left with some noise, okay? And you want to maximize what you can explain, the variability or variation you can explain with this model.
Mm-hmm.
You want to maximize your explanation of this and leave as much as little residuals as you can, okay?
But if you don't, is there an option that you don't have a model and you're looking for a model from your results, or you're
of course there is, but what do you mean?
Because here you said that you have the assumption that for houses it's very active and for it's not. If I don't know the pattern, and can I study something from the result about the pattern?
Yeah. You can apply.
Without they shall.
Yeah, you can. I'm going to ask different questions, but it depends on what you want to ask. But you can use data-driven algorithms or data-driven approaches to try to explain your data, okay?
Let me make the point here. I mean, that's a very important point.
Yeah.
Remember, you have this, very similar to what you showed okay? You have this. Now, you're trying, this is the data. You try to model it as best so that your model would explain this variance, okay? So the model would not fit the data perfectly, okay? Always, because there's some noise in this, your budget. What is your degree of freedom this time? These events that they happen, you cannot change this. These are the events that happen. What you can change, and the hemodynamic response function is simply don't touch it. It's the same. What the only thing that you can change is the size of the hemodynamic response function. So it could be small here, bigger here, you see? But the hemodynamic response function is set. So all you are fitting is these parameters of activation.
These are the betas. Which
these are what you have. These are the parameters that are free for you to change. Okay? And you're trying to explain that. So you don't have to assume that you know the house is going to be bigger than the face. That's what you get when you match the model with the data. That's the free parameters you get. So the free parameter that best fits your data is such that I don't know, houses are bigger than faces. Could be in another box so that faces are bigger than houses. Okay? So that's.
All right. In the next few minutes, we don't have a lot of time, but I want to cover, I mentioned it in the beginning, but now we know a bit more about what we see when we look at Bolt signal. I want to talk about the different designs and their ups and downs, their why we choose to do to one design over another. Okay, so like I said, the basic one is the block design. This is what was used early on and still used, and for a good reason still used. It has very strong detection power. What do I mean? When you wanna measure again, this is nothing to do with MRI. You wanna measure something. You wanna have a good ratio, good SNR, good ratio between the signal and noise. And to do that, you have to have what you call high energy. High energy is high variability and large differentiations, okay? If, for example, let's take this block design, this neuronal activity, forget designs for now, and if these are seconds, you have here, let's say, 18 seconds or something like that, and then some rest. What we said before is that the Bolt signal now have time to decay totally, and here we start again from baseline. Okay, so this is what you see here. What you see, some kind of this is a very basic but convolution with the HRF. You have some rise, you have some prolonged activity, then you have the decay, and by the time you reach here, you've gone to the undershoot. Okay, so this is the baseline, go to the undershoot, and then it rises again. Okay, so what you have here is high energy. Okay. Basically, intuitively, if you think about the signal, is that the amplitude, the difference between these two, the peak and the bottom. Okay. If in our case you would flip the neuronal activity on and off, this is very simple. You just show a stimulus for 1 second, or 2 seconds, then you turn it off for 2 seconds, and on 2 seconds, off 2 seconds. This is what you get, and this is problematic. What you get is a system that is in constant, basically, saturation. Okay, because of the dynamics of the Bolt response, you wouldn't be able to go down all the end. You'll just start going down, and then immediately you excite the system again. The problem with this is that change. Now let's think what we want to measure here. Okay, if we want to measure here, we're good. Okay, we have a lot of signal here. But assuming each these kinds of conditions is alternate, let's say this is space and this is house, this is space and this is house, this is what we're left with, okay? We don't give the system enough time to create more energy in our graph, basically, okay?
So obviously you want to have something like this, and like this. However, there are some limitations. Oh, before I get to the limitation, of course we have to add some noise to the system. So let's do some two stages. This is exactly the fMRI signal we had before, okay? If we add some noise that is not biological noise, you get some kind of high frequency noise. This is something added artificially. And this is looking again at this signal, this lower signal, adding the same noise. Since the signal is so weak, we get much, we get basically noise, and we are left with nothing, okay? Now, if we also add noise to the first part, okay, we have then the neural activity won't ever look like this, okay? We have some kind of variation also in the neural activity part. So now we have even more noise in the fMRI signal, okay? So first we simulated the noise that is from the measuring, and now we add the noise that is the biological noise of the visual system or the neurons. So we have even more noise. So this is, again, this is not real data, but it is very representative of real data, and the point is clear, I think. So if you have a very low signal, like in this case, what you are left with is basically noise. And again, if you try to, let's say, you have the predictors, so you know at each time point what happened, but you're trying to give them weight somehow to explain the signal, you have a much more success here than here, okay? Here you know that at this point you have some kind of predictor, okay, at this point, at that point, faces, houses, and so on and so forth. You can try, and probably you will be able to explain most of the variation by the predictor. You won't be able to explain all this fluctuation, which of course you won't be able because they are noise. But try to explain here this tiny part and you won't be successful. Okay, so this is again what we saw, what I explained now. So the noise on the bottom part is larger than the signal, which is really bad. So we concluded that blocks, if you use them, shouldn't be too short. Okay, there is also one thing that usually people don't think about, but if the blocks are too long, you remember what we do in pre-processing, one of the things we do is we do a high-pass filter, we remove linear trend, of very, very low oscillations, okay? So sometimes the linear trend, because of the reading of the scanner, the baseline can shift. So if we're talking about 20-minute scan, so it can be a bit like this, the signal, the absolute signal, okay? So you remove this. You remove a very very low hertz, very low signal. And if your blocks will be very long, when I'm talking about the 2-minute block, you might remove them when you try to remove this kind of effects, okay? So there's other reasons why you don't want to have a very long block, because it can be very boring and stuff like that. But this is the main reason. But remember still that when trying to get a good signal, like really good signal, block designs are the best. So if your task, if the task allows you to do a block design, it's the simplest design, and it gives you really, really good results. Sometimes you don't want to use it. So we talked about the components of the data. Like I said, this linear low frequency noise, this high frequency noise, and the signal of interest. So you don't want to remove this. So if your block's length somehow are similar to this, you lose the signal. And if they're somehow similar to this, you may cut it off when you do the pre-processing. Okay? So it said here around 16 seconds is good, around 10 seconds is good also, around 20 seconds is good also. It all depends on your task, but this is the ballpark you play with. Yeah.
And the interval?
The interval should be, as a rule of thumb, you try to do it as long as the block, but it doesn't really have to be as long as the block, but it should be at least depends how strict you are. I would say 10 is the minimum. It should be like, 14, 16.
Okay.
If you want to, we'll get to that in a minute. But if you want to have the full undershoot play its part and dissolve and basically go back to baseline, you want to try to have at least like 15 seconds. You can make it a bit shorter if you counterbalance the ratio, the order of the trials. Remind me in 2 seconds if I don't, in 5 minutes if I don't mention it. I should get to it to give you a complete answer. So we covered block design, very simple, and now I'm going to talk about a slow event related and then rapid event related. So slow event related, as Odi told you, and had a little spoiler here, is very good at estimation of the signal. So again, if you have some stimulus, or let's call it neural, some kind of impulse function, you know the timing, you convolve it with the HRF, and you get some kind of predicted data. And because you give time for all this to play out, you have a very, very clear representation of the data. There's no overlap. Okay? So you can really see the HRF, okay? So the experiment I mentioned before about calculating the HRF, they use this. However, and this is what we talked about before, the detection part is a bit is less than optimal in this case. So just to set us on the same page, detection is seen basically the percent signal change or how this region is more active in one condition than other condition. Estimation is to characterize the time course of the response. Okay.
It's not optimal because
it's
short?
Yeah, it's not optimal because detection, basically you want to create as much data as you can. You are talking about statistical difference in the end, so you want to have a lot of data, a lot of time points to achieve statistical significance. If you use this slow event related, you just run out of time. You, for every, let's say, 1 second or 2 seconds of stimulus, you have to have 20 seconds or so, 15 seconds of blank period. It's just very, very inefficient. If you want to reach, and you remember that if you use a block design of 10 seconds, basically you get an enormous response, right? It goes up and stays up for 10 seconds and then goes down. Yeah, to have the same amount, the same effect, you have to have at least 10 trials of 1 second or even more, because there is an added, the sum here is bigger than its part, so it's making a 10 slow event related sometimes won't add up to the amount of statistical difference that you get from a long block. So it's really, really not efficient time-wise, and time is very important in the MRI. But there are some cases in which it's good, and again, these cases I'm going to show you one example has to do with estimation. When you want to estimate the response, the shape of the response, that's good. And this example is an experiment where they demonstrated it, the importance when they wanted to separate, in this case, some action that some noise that is due to action and some actual response. And again, it all comes down to your ability to dissociate two different contributing parts to the observed signal. So for example, if you have blocks, these are times. These are the seconds, okay, so maybe you have a 15 second block, okay, and then you have ideal time. And what you see here is two different signals, okay? One is the bold activity, okay, with noise. And you can see here something that resembles a block. I mean, you can intuitively see where the activity was. And here you have motion artifact. Now, the task here was jaw clenching. It was like moving the jaw, okay, for 15 seconds. And as you can see, you have a very, very strong signal. Again, if you're talking about the difference here, the energy here, for the motion artifacts, Okay, at least in this case, this was the purpose of the paper. So they made it like that, that it's even, the signal is even larger than the actual ball. Okay, so they basically created, artificially created a situation to demonstrate the point that you have some artifact, and the artifact is really correlated with the ball response. Okay, and in this case, it even yields much more, like stronger signal. Okay.
They had a task plus the jaw.
No, the task was the jaw clenching, and they had some. I think they had another condition. I don't remember what
can
it was.
Check the ball signal when I do that. I don't
remember
that.
Oh, you say yeah, yeah. No, they saw. They saw also something. They
okay,
had some activation yet.
Okay.
But I think the. It's a good question. Maybe they had. No, it's not written here. I don't remember if the task was something visual or something, a motor imagery or something like that. Okay?
Mm-hmm.
But I think it was something visual. Something very simple, like the flickering.
Mm-hmm.
I can, so I can
every
go back.
Time it flickers, they need to
come. Yeah. Okay? So the motion artifacts are very, very strong. And then the motion artifact, really, it's the most, it's the strongest artifact there is. You really want to avoid it. But again, here it was. Again, the point was to see that to show that there is a high correlation, and sometimes all this signal can be masked by this signal. Okay. However, when you have a slow event related, you have one impulse of signal. Okay, and you let the signal decay, you can really differentiate between the two. And that is because the different time frames, the different dynamics of the, in this case, the jaw clenching, which is, okay, that's it, instead of doing things 15 minutes straight, and the ball, which again, even if you have a very, very, very short stimulus, you still have this development in time because of the vascular system and the hemodynamic process behind it. Okay, so now you can basically really tell which voxel is responding to this, and which voxel is showing this behavior. Okay, this is very immediate, very sharp, then goes down. This has the slow development and slow decay. And this is the ideal, of course. There is no. And here you can see the when the jaw clenching and the visual stimulus was presented. So again, this is just to make a point. And the point is that there are some. Situations in which you want to estimate the shape of the HRF very precisely. It's very important to your research questions, or it can differentiate between, like here, between some noise, specific noise. Usually you want to avoid noise altogether, okay? However, maybe your task does involve moving the mouth for some reason, okay? And you want to separate this. Another situation in which you want to use the slow event related, which has nothing to do with this, is sometimes you want to do something auditory, and then you want to do some short, very short auditory cue, and then you can do a sparse, people call sparse scanning. So you can, if I don't know if you've been in the MRI before, but it does very, very high frequency sound. And you can stop the sound, you can stop the gradient moving for several seconds to be able to hear something, say something, and then just scan for 2 seconds, okay? So this kind of design allows you to do it. This has nothing to do with getting a better estimation of the IGRF, it's just some kind of behavioral demand, okay, that you have. So sometimes you want to use them, but like I said, it's very boring. And you have a very poor detection because of the ratio of time. Basically, you collect far less data. And meanwhile, your subject can fall asleep and so on. So usually you try to not do that. Usually you try to go to block design if you have something very simple that you can do block design. And otherwise, you try to do rapid event related. Time. Yeah, we have 15 minutes, 10 minutes to cover this. Okay. So, rapid event related relies heavily on the fact that you can combine the signal, the different predictors linearly to create, to estimate the total response or total signal. because now what we'll see using a very, very short interval, so everything tops on the other, okay? You have some summation of the signal because you don't have time for the signal to go back to baseline.
The same estimates?
No. No.
But you need to know the response of the stimulus.
Yeah, so no. So the thing is, what you usually do, and we get that in the GLM, but like we said briefly before, you use the same canonical HRF for all stimuli. You assume, maybe it's wrong, but you assume to a certain point, that's what you do, you assume a certain HRF basic function together with the stimulus, okay? You assume what changes is the relative contribution of the different stimuli. So if you have stimulus 1 at point 1, okay, you have, let's say, just a 1 versus 0, which is the baseline, then you apply, you multiply this 1, okay, with the canonical HRF. Then you have a different one, now this was a house, now you have a face. You do the same for the face, you assume the same canonical thing. If the stimulation is longer, the convolution will result with a different with different function altogether. Again, because like you said, for video, the result is different. Where was it? I have to. Okay. Where is it? Here. Okay. So you have this, right? So you have different stimuli. Okay. Do you mean if you use different intensities, for example, different contrasts and stuff like that? What do you mean? Yeah. Right, but this is what you want
to
estimate.
How after the output I can to...
Yeah, okay, so this is what, we'll talk about it thoroughly, the GLM, but basically you have this, and you want to see the combination of these, okay?
Yes.
So this is always the same, no, doesn't matter, again, I don't know if it's completely true, but this is common practice, you use the same HRF. Now, to get this, you have to have a linear combination of the different time, and like Udi illustrated well, these two time points are set because this is what you gave the, this is the non-changing variable that you have, okay? This is what you gave the subject, you know exactly where in time, when the subject, so what? And the only thing that you can play with is the relative contribution of this. Okay, to play with this so that this combination or linear combination will give you a shape that is similar to the actual data that you have. Okay, the way you model these are usually just 1 and 0. Okay, you can try to model this in a very parametric way if you have a strong assumption as to what the response will be. But usually, when you're talking about visual stimuli, you just model this as ones and zeros. Usually, you'll get separation very fast. So you'll see the a face, for example, for 2 seconds, and basically you get a full response. But we'll do that very thoroughly and in a very organized way in a couple of weeks after you come back from Ethiopia, those of you who are going. Okay, so let's just finish the last design, and I wanna, I wanna to go over this. So again, the basis for all this is the idea that you can linearly combine everything. And I'm not talking about what we talked about now specifically, but the basic feature of characteristic. Thank you. Of the linear of the ball that is can be linearly summed. Okay. So. If, and we show it in a second, if we can use this and present something before the signal from the previous stimulus has decayed, we have a very, very important advantage. First of all, it's less boring for the subject. Of course, you can collect more data in a certain time frame. It enables oddball experiments, so it's all kind of experiment when you play with a different condition and you don't have to wait, you can do things very quickly, okay? It enables some estimation of the HRF. I'm not going to talk about it now, but you can make what Udi said before, deconvolution. You can try to assess the shape of the HRF, although not as good as you can with slow event related. There is some, the detection power is a bit lower than block design. This basically means that I have to have a very large number of repetitions if I want to reach the same statistical significance, the same power as a block design, okay? And it's, again, it's more sensitive than block designs to the accuracy of the HRF model. This is because you build, well, if you have a block design, just intuitively, if you have a block design for 10 seconds, let's say you build the response, then you stay saturated for some time, okay? You have a very, very considerable chunk of basically signal, very strong signal, okay? You're less sensitive to minor alterations with each rise and fall of the ball signal. You can think about it. I have, let's say I have 6 repetitions of bold. Okay, remember there is variation. I have 6 repetitions of bold, also, just intuitively, it's not my purpose here to go into the details of that, but if you have 6 times something like that, with a very long, very robust signal, or 50 times very short signal with a lot of variations here, okay? So you have more sensitivity to the model, okay? If you use one HRF, you are more sensitive to its shape. It will affect your signal, stronger effect on your signal if you're using a fast event related.
It doesn't sound like a disadvantage. Can you maybe rephrase it?
It is a disadvantage if you assume, it may affect your signal in a way that you cannot model, basically, or you don't account for them. Okay, so you get more variation, basically introduce to your model more variation that you cannot account for, okay? So you get some extra, let's say, noise. It's not like noise. It's noise that is the cause of it. The noise is basically the inconsistency between your model and the actual HRF that you get. Thank you. So this inconsistency is more has more effect when you use rapid event related design, okay? And that means that you might have slightly more noise than signal, because you don't account for that noise, okay? You can't model it. You see that you have the ratio of your what you actually can model and what is considered residuals or noise is a bit it's less favorable. However, it is a great design, and usually, today a lot of people use that design. I use it a lot of times. And again, the main motivation to use that first and most is the behavioral task or the behavioral demand. You can do a lot with this kind of design that you cannot do with block design, okay? And vice versa, but you really have to think about the original question and what is most suitable for what. The downside, like I said, you have to have a lot of repetitions to get a certain amount of signal, basically. And I personally had some result that I could not duplicate with the event-related design that I had in block design. And my motivation to try them in different ways was because I used some block design, and the interpretation of my result could be go either way. And now to differentiate between the interpretation, I had to go behaviorally to design tasks differently. I had to go to event-related design. This solved one problem, but introduced another. I had less SNR basically, and had was less successful in finding results that I found in the block design. And now there's a big question. Did I not find the results in the second experiment because that's the result? That there is no the changing in the behavioral paradigm now the effect? Or did I change the level of SNR, that the level of sensitivity that I have, and now I couldn't detect that effect? That's always a problem.
Can you give an example for a task of this kind of
design? Yeah, first. I think if you from my okay, I'll do one more slide and then I'll give you an example, and maybe that will clear the issue. So what you want to do is enter jitter, okay? Jitter is just making the rate in which you present the trials random, okay? You introduce some spacing, and we'll talk about why you do that. But that actually also answers your question. When you want to insert some inconsistency or unexpected timing or whatever, or you want to have expected timing but very, very close events, different events that come close together, you want to have this kind of event-related design. Okay, so for example, I want to show let's say something, just an image, I'm checking memory, and then I want, after one image, to do a different kind of event. Let's call it a recall event or some interfering event or whatever. So I want to have one image, and I want this image to show only 1 second and then disappear, and then I want to do something of a different time. Then I cannot work with block design. I just don't want to show more than 1 second, and I can't put in the same block event of two different types. Okay, I won't be able to analyze it, right? So if I have the, let's say, encoding part, when I view the image, and then some kind of test, if I want to do it in a different day, that's a different story altogether.